For decades, firefighters have relied on aqueous film-forming foams to battle blazes. AFFFs are ubiquitous at airports, where they're always on hand to protect public safety and property. But because most AFFF formulations contain PFAS, they now represent a major environmental hazard and challenge for airports across the US. I talked with Jill Greene, an environmental expert with extensive experience in this area. She broke down the challenge of AFFFs and PFAS, the efforts to remove PFAS from airports, and what advice she's giving her airport clients. Check it out.
So AFFF stands for aqueous film forming foam, which is a type of Class B firefighting foam. Class B foams are used for large petroleum and fuel fires. AFFF was developed in the 1960s, and one of the drivers for the development of this foam was the tragedy that occurred on the USS Forrestal, where a Zuni rocket accidentally went off, hit other planes. It was a terrible, terrible tragedy, and the sailors were entirely ill-equipped to put out this fire. And so the military developed a specification for extinguishing fuel fires, and surfactants were added that allow these products to really smother and cover the petroleum to put them out. So they're incredibly effective. And airports right now are mandated by the FAA to use a Class B firefighting foam that meets the DoD's specification for fire extinguishment. And right now, the only commercially available foams that can meet that specification contain PFAS. The agencies are really working to develop products that are more environmentally friendly, but that also have the same fire suppression properties as AFFF. So DoD has drafted a new specification with different extinguishment requirements, and both FAA and DoD have tested a handful of commercially available foams against this new specification, and there are several that are looking to be promising.
When it comes to cleaning out AFFF from a fire suppression system, I mean, can you just rinse it out? Something tells me that it's more complicated than just sort of like rinsing it out with water.
So this is the million-dollar question, Andrew. It's probably more than $1 million. So airports have already switched foams in the past few years. Airports have moved from the long-chain C8 foams to more modern C6 foams, which still meet the specification, but don't have some of those bad actors like PFOA and PFOS. And typically what has happened is that you do a triple rinse procedure, which means you drain out the old foam, you generally rinse the firefighting apparatus, tank, hoses, what have you, several times, and then put the new foam in. What we're finding is that the PFAS will bind to the inside of all of this equipment, and it's very difficult to get that residual PFAS to dissolve in water. And so what you see is kind of a rebound of PFAS concentrations that's coming out of the equipment from old foam being stored there for so long that's now going to contaminate the new foam.
PFAS regulations are evolving rapidly, and it can be a challenge to keep up. That's why CDM Smith built a PFAS regulations tracker that makes it easy to find the current regulations in each U.S. state. To check it out, go to cdmsmith.com/PFAS or click the link below. All right, let's get back to the conversation. I know this is an area of emerging research and that there's a lot of R&D going on right now. And I know that you and your colleagues are undertaking some federally funded research to tackle this challenge. Can you share a little bit about some of those projects or things that are interesting to you that are currently being looked into?
Sure. This is a huge problem because military installations, commercial airports, chemical companies, fuel farms, everyone is looking towards transitioning to a fluorine-free foam, but nobody knows how to decontaminate the foam dispensing equipment. It's a real, real problem. So DoD is funding a series of projects. CDM Smith is participating in two, with the goal of evaluating environmentally sustainable products and techniques for effectively decontaminating foam dispensing equipment. Recently, we're out in the field testing our products out on real fire trucks. So data is being collected now, and we're really excited to share the results.
So this is a lot to think about for airports around the country. What advice do you have for airports? What should they be doing now to get ahead of this challenge and sort of prepare for what's coming in the future?
It's a challenge because the regulations and the science are really changing on almost a daily basis, and keeping up with everything is really challenging. I think at the most basic level, while an airport still needs to use AFFF, is just trying to minimize the liabilities from this product. So making sure you're doing your spill management procedures. If you have AFFF in a fire suppression system, making sure that that system is inspected and operating properly, and reducing the potential for it accidentally to go off. If you do have a release of AFFF in an emergency or even an accidental situation, making sure that you have solid emergency response plans in place to try to minimize that foam from getting out into the environment. And so airports should really have a team involved that incorporates representatives from across their organization. So the operations folks, the firefighters, your legal department, government affairs, and even community relations, if there is an issue where the public is interested in knowing what the airport is doing.
Jill, this is a very tricky and obviously rapidly evolving issue. Really appreciate all that you're doing to tackle this challenge. And thank you for talking with me about this today. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Andrew.